And a number of other interesting crops could be used in Ireland as well. Everything from Jerusalem artichokes, which are native to the Scandinavian countries, but grow all the way down into even Spain. And we can grow quite a number of crops. We can even get alcohol from grass. Grass produces a small amount of sugar. And when you harvest the grass and process it, you can recover the sugar and then feed the protein in the grass and the other nutrients to cattle. You know, it's called leaf protein concentrate when you do that. Now, of course, it's easier to just let the cattle graze, you know, but if you want to extract the sugar first, it's possible to get reasonable yields that way as well and get multiple products.
Okay, so you have, for the summer here, as short as it is, everybody has lawns, everybody cuts them, and everybody wonders, how the hell am I going to get rid of my clippings? So we could convert that easily into fuel.
Well, and animal feed, like I said,
you
get multiple products out of it. You get, you know, you do get the sugar to make alcohol. Now, there's all the talk nowadays about cellulose, which is the majority of what grass clippings are made of. Cellulose, of course, is plant fiber, and it's made from thousands of sugars linked together. But the process for breaking cellulose down into alcohol is a tough one. And, you know, the thing that does it best are cattle. So, you know, they break down cellulose into, you know, food that they can get energy from. So my favorite strategy with grass would be to extract the small amount of sugar and then use the remainder as animal feed. The reason why I say that is that all the cellulose research that's being done now, anything that gets mildly successful is patented and then purchased by the oil companies. It doesn't do us any good to switch from oil to alcohol if it's still under the oil company control, because the point of what I'm talking about is that we need to take control of the energy supply again ourselves. And we can do that with many, many crops that we, you know, have farmers grow instead of oil companies. And I quite frankly trust farmers a lot more than oil companies to have my best interest at heart.
Yeah. Okay, so for Ireland's, from Ireland's point of view, we have kelp. Now, we'd have to figure out the legality of who owns what, who harvests it, tax implications, all the rest. And then on land, there is the possibility to take sort of marshy waste ground that is just sitting there and grow certain plants that would be self-sustaining, wouldn't harm the environment, and then we could have a yield of fuel from them in a sustainable way. Is that what you're saying?
Well, that's part of it, but we can also grow crops that, you know, both benefit the current, you know, animal agriculture business, you know, in other words, milk and cheese, et cetera, at the same time that we get fuel. Because, you see, cattle can't really digest the starch that's in grain. You know, they basically, you know, it goes out with the manure. And so the reason why we feed grain to cattle is that we want them to digest the protein and fat that's in the grain. So when we make alcohol, we only take the starch out at the front end. So we do that and then feed the byproduct, which in the United States we call dried distiller's grains, or the mash that's left over after we make alcohol. And when we feed that to cattle, they gain just as much weight as if we would have fed them the whole grain. Now, beets, it's very similar. You know, in terms of being a multi-purpose crop, we get both 4 times the alcohol we'd get from a grain crop, because beets are more productive, and we get twice the animal feed per acre that we would get from a grain crop. The pulp that's left over from beet production into alcohol is extremely good for dairy cattle. So the idea of getting more out of our crops, you know, getting energy and food, is really the practical reality, and that's how you make money in the alcohol business, not just by making the fuel, but by making multiple products.
Okay, I can see the logic behind that. So put side by side current petroleum products such as gasoline or petrol, as we call it here, and ethanol or biofuel, what is the equivalent cost to make from start to finish the gasoline and start to finish to make the ethanol?
Well, the price of gasoline, of course, is highly dependent on the price of oil. And in the U.S. right now, if I was to convert to liters, I guess we're looking at, in U.S. dollars, roughly, oh, it would be almost 50 cents a liter to make gasoline. But alcohol can be made from many materials, you know, that are low cost for 10 cents or 20 cents per liter, depending on what we're, you know, starting with. For instance, there's a lot of waste products you can use to make alcohol. You know, when you have places that bake large quantities of bread, et cetera, or make candy or even soda pop, et cetera, there's lots of waste materials left over that typically, you know, don't have a good place to go. And those can all be made into alcohol. So now you're talking just a few pennies per liter, basically. The process of making alcohol is very inexpensive compared to refining for oil. And it could even be done on the small scale. Now, there's a bakery product we have in the U.S. called Donuts, and I imagine you probably have something like that there.
Yeah.
So I used to make alcohol from donuts in the United States. And, you know, a couple of cubic meters of donuts, which is, you know, what my truck would hold when I would go pick them up at the donut shop, you know, that would make me 400 liters of alcohol. So, you know, small quantities of some of these more concentrated carbohydrates like candy waste or, you know, any of the bakery products are very good for making alcohol at a very low price.
So the ethanol as a fuel would be, say, a fourth or a fifth of the price to the consumer and as compared to gasoline. As a
depends.
At current prices.
You know, it all depends on your tax, you know, situation as well, because, you know, a large percentage of what the price of fuel is tax. You know, now in the United States, we do very little taxing of fuel because corporations here don't want to pay the tax. So basically, in most places in Europe, there's a fair amount of tax added to the price of fuel to help pay for mass transit and other consequences of using fuel. So it really, you know, a lot of it has to do with how the tax structure is set up. But if you're making it yourself for your own company, let's say you have a fleet of two or three trucks in your business, or you're a farmer with, you know, a truck and a tractor and a couple of other things, avoiding the cost of fuel is, you know, really significant for you because, you know, the tax situation doesn't make so much difference to you. It's the fact that you're avoiding the overall cost. But the importance to the nation is what's very significant, because when you spend money on gasoline, it leaves the country instantly for a Geneva bank account of some big corporation. But let's say, you know, Gabriel, you have a farm and you're making some alcohol and you go ahead and sell it to your engineer there. And your engineer takes, you know, has given you some money for that alcohol. So then you go ahead and get a haircut downtown, and you give some of that alcohol money to the barber. And then the barber needs to go get some carpentry work done and takes that alcohol money that, you know, he's gotten from you and uses it to hire the carpenter. And the carpenter hires the mechanic to fix his car, and the mechanic wants to get some organic vegetables, which you're growing on the farm, using byproducts from the alcohol process, and you give some of that money back to you. The point is that capital just circulated around the community and never left the country. And each one of those transactions, or many of those transactions, may have generated tax revenue for the state. So when the fuel that the country needs is produced within the country and used within the country, the capital stays in the country. And that's tremendously important because oil companies are huge parasites on the nation's economies. So, you know, even if the price was the same as gasoline, the benefit to the national economy is tremendous by making your own fuel.
Okay. What about the pollution? What about the effects, the different effects of between petrol and the ethanol? And emissions. Okay.
Well, you know, that's one of the best things about ethanol is that it's essentially pollution-free. typically 97 to 98% pollution.